I'm Rick Howard, and this is Santa Monica, California, my home. Now, if you go in that direction west, you cross the Pacific Ocean. But if you go the other way, east, you cross the U.S., the Atlantic Ocean, and you end up in Western Europe, our destination. And there's a good reason I'm standing in front of a wood sculpture here. Art is a very important part of this story. But let me start at the beginning. This story really didn't begin in Europe at all. It began in Cairo, Egypt. I'd gone to Egypt to make a music video for a singer-songwriter named Lynn Davison, singing her song entitled Third World. But after the video was finished, Lynn told me she was beginning a one-month musical tour that would take her through seven countries in Western Europe. And she suggested that I travel along with her and we could collaborate on a project. Now this gave me an idea. I've always wanted to make a particular movie. You see, I love art, and I've always wanted to tell the story of seven amazing artists who have lived over the past 500 years in Europe. They're all famous, they're all geniuses. You'll recognize their names once we get into this. But more than their art, I wanted to tell the story of their true life adventures in the Europe of years gone by. Now, Lynn would be traveling through the towns and countries that they called home. So I decided to follow a modern-day artist working in Europe, while at the same time taking an intimate glimpse back into the lives of these seven amazing men. Now, I want you to think of Lynn as sort of a tour guide to follow, because she planned this trip very carefully with the help of a good travel agent and a lot of research, and the result is one of the most beautiful movies and best stories I've ever told. So we're going to take off now, but before getting on to Europe, we're going to take a few moments to go to Cairo, Egypt, to see a little bit of Lynn Davison singing her song entitled Third World. Let's be on our way.
Egypt, a 5,000-year-old civilization. When it was built, the Great Pyramid was the tallest man-made structure in the world. There's Lynn. We're going to be seeing a lot of her on this trip. Here's me and my camel Clyde. Clyde had bad manners and terrible breath. This is how many people travel around the Mediterranean during the warmer months. They don't make you rent a cabin or a stateroom. They let you camp right out on deck. You can even pitch a tent out here if you like. It's an inexpensive way to travel during the warm months. It had been pretty warm all night. And shortly after the sun comes up, people start waking up one at a time and getting acquainted. We're going to be traveling by train. That's how everybody travels around in Europe, and we're going to be visiting seven countries: Spain, France, Germany, Holland, Switzerland, Austria, and Italy. We'll start out in Rome. The Colosseum is probably the most well-recognized symbol for Rome during her heyday. Story has it that about 800 BC, two baby boys named Romulus and Remus were thrown into the Tiber River to drown, but instead they were rescued and raised by a female wolf. When they grew up, they built Rome on seven hills. Actually, slaves built Rome, and it's an empire that lasted for 1,000 years. The ancient Romans had a taste for blood in their entertainment, and they got their fill here at the Colosseum. 2,000 years ago, 50,000 numbered seats here accommodated screaming Roman citizens, as they watched criminals, Christians, gladiators, and wild animals fight to the death in almost every imaginable scenario. In the year 107 AD, the Emperor Trajan, in order to impress his predecessor, killed 11,000 wild animals and 10,000 gladiators here in one really big fight. The Emperor and the crowd would watch the carnage below from these seats, and then at decisive moments, the Emperor would give a thumbs up or a thumbs down, meaning life or death. Many died this way, but some, by fighting bravely and impressing the Emperor and the crowd, gained their freedom this way. In the year 70 BC, a gladiator named Spartacus impressed the crowd, received his freedom, and led a revolt. He plundered the Italian peninsula for almost 2 years with an army of ex-slaves and gladiators until he was finally captured and most of them were crucified along the Appian Way. The unfortunate entertainers of the day entered the Colosseum through a maze of underground tunnels. At the end of the day, they'd lead the same way, some alive, some dead, and some inside the bellies of wild animals. The cages that you see down below there were covered by an artificial floor. The animals and the men would wait below until it was their turn to come upstairs and fight. They could even flood the Colosseum with water through these tunnels and stage full-size naval battles with warships, fighting, burning, and sinking all within this arena. Imagine how that must have looked. Near the Colosseum, other ruins stand, like the Forum. The Romans' favorite form of entertainment was not really held in the Colosseum, though. It was held at the Circus Maximus, where their chariot races were run. Each chariot was pulled by four horses at a breakneck pace around an oval track. There were no rules, or very few. Some would die, one would win, but the Romans' taste for blood would be satisfied. But this was the stage of civilization back at the time when Rome was civilization. The whole known world was either Roman, Greek, or barbarian. Nobody was sure what the Egyptians were up to, but Rome was the undisputed superpower of its day. All roads led to Rome. A word of warning to modern-day tourists in this area, this place is full of pickpockets. They look like little beggars, but actually they're very skillful thieves that will be off with your wallet or your purse in a heartbeat if you're not very careful. Rome has been described as a glorious junkyard of Western civilization. It's a city with a history thousands of years older than New York or Hong Kong, with just as much excitement as either place. It's a little bit of an assault on the senses when you get off the train or the plane here. The sights, the smells, and the sounds are a little overwhelming until you finally get used to them. From Rome, now we're going to head down along the Italian coast, past Naples. 2,000 years ago, all roads led to Rome because the Romans were the only ones building them. They conquered so much not just because they had great armies and legions, but they could also build roads and get those armies where they needed them quickly to fight. They also built a very impressive aqueduct system to bring water throughout the empire. Just past Naples, you arrive at the ancient city of Pompeii. Pompeii was a beautiful city on the Mediterranean, a very upscale Roman resort. Wealthy Romans from all over the empire would come here to enjoy the pleasures of the Mediterranean sun and Pompeii. It was a wealthy city of about 20,000 people, about 12,000 Roman citizens, and about 8,000 slaves. And the city was really controlled by the wealthy patrician families. In an upscale family home, the buildings of the home were usually centered around a central courtyard. And the household had to be self-sufficient. You couldn't go to the corner store for things. This meant you had to maintain an army of well-trained slaves to run the household, some to cook food, some to prepare it, some to grow the crops, some to watch the stock and the children, some to make furniture and clothing, and all hopefully under the watchful eye of a benevolent head of the house. In ancient Rome, the single family unit was the head of Roman society. This meant that a father or a head of a household could actually have his son executed for disobeying him. This happened. But this was the state of civilization back at a time when Pompeii was really the place to be. The goddess Venus, the goddess of love, was the goddess of the city. And it was the place everybody wanted to be. That is, right up until that horrible day in 79 AD, when Mount Vesuvius erupted. Vesuvius was an ash volcano, and it pumped tons and tons of volcanic ash into the sky, completely burying the city of Pompeii and the nearby city of Herculaneum in just one afternoon. The terrified citizens and visitors ran for their lives trying to make it to the sea as the tons and tons of volcanic ash descended on them. Some hid in their homes, but they were almost all killed. This site was not excavated until 1962. They were still in exactly the grotesque positions in which they had died. About 25,000 people died that day. But even though the volcano killed most of the people of Pompeii, it perfectly preserved their city. The volcanic ash packed in here, preserving the fresco paintings on the walls, the mosaics, the statues, making Pompeii the most well-preserved ancient ruins I've ever seen. Walking around Pompeii, you really get a feeling of what life was like back during the time of Christ. One group of people got to see the eruption from offshore on the Isle of Capri, not far off the Italian coast. From the port of Naples here, there are many boats that will take you out to Capri. It's not a very long ride because Capri is pretty close and the boats are pretty fast. A flock of seagulls was following us out there. Capri means Island of the Goats, but it really deserves a better name. It's a beautiful jewel of an island in the blue Mediterranean. Back during Greek times, magic mermaids called sirens supposedly sang their songs from the cliffs of Capri, and the songs were hypnotic. Any sailor unfortunate enough to hear the songs of the sirens was immediately drawn to his death. It's said that one Greek captain actually had his crew lash him to the mast so he wouldn't hear the songs of the sirens, transgress, and lead his ship and crew to their deaths on the rocks of Capri. Down on the coastline here, it's a beautiful Italian waterfront town, typical of many, 100 or 200 years old. But then when you go about 425 feet up the hill here, you go a couple thousand years back into history, back to the time of the Roman Empire. The Emperor Augusta, on his way home from a campaign, stopped off at Capri and immediately fell in love with the island. He created a Roman resort. Sumptuous palaces and villas were built. Then the Emperor Tiberius ruled the entire Roman Empire from this island with a fleet of ships and a system of signal fires. At one time, the entire population here watched the death of two cities, Pompeii and Herculaneum, from this natural amphitheater. Walking around these streets, you really get a feeling of what life was like back during those days. But then after the fall of the Roman Empire, Capri fell on some pretty hard times. Without the protection of the Roman legions, the emperors and conquerors of the Mediterranean passed Capri around. It seemed to be a beautiful jewel that everybody wanted to possess, but that nobody could hang on to for long. Who knows, at one time maybe a Roman emperor sat on this very same beach. On the way back to Naples, a flock of seagulls was following us again. And watching them fly, I was thinking a lot. The first artist I'm going to introduce you to, he lived about 500 years ago. His name was Leonardo da Vinci, and he was a true genius of the 15th century. By watching birds fly, he figured out how their wings provided lift and designed flying machines that might have worked had he had the materials to build them. Leonardo is best known as a painter who did the two most famous paintings in the world. The Mona Lisa, which hangs behind bulletproof glass in the Louvre in Paris, with a very interesting smile that seems to change with different lighting. And The Last Supper, a very large painting that's been badly damaged by time and the elements. This was at a time when painters could really only make a living by working for the wealthy, the royalty, or the church. And by far the church had most of the money, so most of the paintings of the time depict scenes from the Bible. Or they're paintings of the wealthy. But Leonardo was much more than just a painter. He was a scientist who studied astronomy back at a time when most people thought that the world was flat. Even though he said that war was madness, he designed weapons for the armies of his day. Even a battle tank, hundreds of years before the motor could be invented to power it. A parachute, more than four centuries before the airplane. Even a helicopter that might have worked had he had the materials to build it and the motor to power it then. But probably his most amazing accomplishments were in the world of human anatomy. This was back at a time when the Catholic Church decreed that it was blasphemous and illegal to cut into a dead body. It's said that Leonardo actually had grave robbers bring him bodies at night, and he would dissect them in his basement, taking his notes backwards so nobody could read them. It's said during the warm Mediterranean summers, Leonardo reeked of death, but he did manage to map the inside of the human body hundreds of years before medical science caught up with him. Even how a fetus developed in the womb, hundreds of years before anybody else knew these things. Leonardo da Vinci, a true artistic genius of the 15th century. And then there was Michelangelo. Born 23 years after Leonardo, they lived at the same time and they didn't really like each other. They were rivals. Michelangelo is probably best known for his paintings on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel in the Vatican in Rome. an entire history of the Bible painted on the walls and the ceiling of this room over a period of almost 4 years. It's said that Michelangelo was a little bit jealous of Leonardo, the old master, but in my opinion, he had nothing to be jealous of. In his 89-year lifetime, he created an amazing amount of work. One of the few self-portraits of Michelangelo here, the profile looking at the skeleton during his younger days. His David is probably the most famous statue in the world. He said he was more of a sculptor than a painter, and he could put true human feelings into cold marble. He said that God had actually put those statues in the marble for him. As an artist, it was just his job to chip them out and set them free. He didn't really have much respect for Leonardo, though. He thought that Leonardo was lazy. We only have about 12 paintings that we know of by Leonardo. He didn't understand that Leonardo was so interested in so many different subjects that he could not devote himself totally to art or any one thing, whereas Michelangelo was a devoted artist. And during his 89-year lifetime, he created an amazing amount of work. 89 years is a long time to live 500 years ago. His statues are so realistic, they almost seem to be breathing. The gentle features of the Virgin Mary and the loving face of Christ, so realistic, it almost looks as though he's going to speak. Michelangelo, the other artistic genius of the 15th century. You can find a lot of the work of both men in the Louvre here in Paris. But now we're heading across the Italian peninsula to a city that both of them visited, even though they didn't spend much time here, but we're on our way now to my favorite city in Italy. We're going to Venice. Venice is a fascinating city built in a lagoon on 18 islands in the year 421 AD, primarily by people fleeing what was left of the Roman Empire. After the fall of the Roman Empire, the Roman legions turned into mercenary armies plundering the Italian peninsula, and Venice was easy to defend because of all this water. One thing that Leonardo did often was to follow people around with a sketch pad. He would sketch them and take the sketches home and paint them. These two lovers were on this bridge every evening, and I do the same thing. I film people without them seeing me and edit the film. I call it headhunting. It's early in the morning, and the only ones about are the cats. There are hundreds, maybe thousands of cats in Venice. It's hard to turn around here without seeing a big cat looking at you from somewhere. They range from scraggly strays to well-kept house cats. They keep the rodent population down, and they really give you the feeling that they own Venice, and they just allow people to live here to take care of them. Actually, I think most cats in the world have that attitude. Now, Linn let it be known that she was a musician at night, but her days were her own, and she always found charming little hotel rooms really overlooking the color of a place. The same kind of a place that filmmakers look for. We always want a window that we can look out and get the true flavor of the place that we're visiting, preferably without being seen by anybody. My favorite time in Venice is early in the morning, when the early morning sun brings out the vivid colors here. Venice is the most colorful city I've ever seen. There is a lot of activity here in the morning. People going to work, kids going to school, but nobody's taking a bus or a taxi or even a car. The only ways to get around Venice are walking or floating. I mentioned the type of filming I call headhunting. It's best done early in the morning, and here's headhunting at its best. What a head, huh? There are water taxis and water buses here, and they take you along the big S-shaped Grand Canal that divides Venice in half. It's really the way that most people get around here. But there are always the gondolas as well. The Rialto Bridge was built in 1592, and by the year 1420, Venice was the wealthiest city in the world. They exported salt, fish, glassware, and ships both for war and trade, and they imported spices, silk, and exotic luxuries from the world over. There's really no limit to how many people they'll squeeze on these water taxis, but they really are the best way to get out to the Piazza di San Marcos, where the city meets the sea. Built in 1094 AD, This is also where Venice's favorite son, Marco Polo, took off at the age of 17 with his father and his uncle to see the world. He spent 25 years traveling through Baghdad, Iran, Afghanistan, finally making it all the way up into Mongolia, where he was befriended and even employed by the conqueror king, Kublai Khan. When Marco Polo returned, he really did more than anybody else to bring Venice into trade with the rest of the world, connecting the world with Asia. Venice was controlled by an unbroken chain of families called doges for more than 1,000 years. And much of the language we use today came from Venice. They gave us the words ghetto, magazine, arsenal, coffee, and much of the banking terminology used the world over. But Venice has a problem. The whole city is sinking at the rate of about 1 foot every 100 years. They're really beginning to worry about this. This area floods during high tides. If they don't figure out a solution, Venice won't last forever. The gondolas are really the most romantic way of getting around here. In a way, these little boats are kind of like time machines. For when you turn off the big Grand Canal up one of the narrow little canals, you seem to have gone back into history. When you look around, it's really not hard to tell that this city's actually sinking. You know that they didn't build those doors and windows that close to the water originally. And at one time, the Rialto Bridge was probably quite a bit higher as well. You often hear singing out in these little back canals. Many of the gondoliers sing, and some of them have some pretty powerful voices. You can hear them echoing off these ancient bricks. And out on the Grand Canal, you never really know what you're going to run into. You might even see a floating wedding going by. This is probably two very nice Italian families marrying their children, but to me, they kind of look like a mafia wedding. The reason why is some of the looks I got, like by him. The wedding party didn't seem to have any problem being filmed, but their gondoliers turned around and gave me a hard look. I guess they thought I was the paparazzi. When you turn up one of these narrow little canals, the walls literally drip with history. Five 500 years ago, people like Leonardo and Michelangelo were sitting around outdoor cafes like this and discussing the world of their day. And the world of their day was a fascinating one, the Renaissance. The old beliefs and ways of the Dark Ages were giving way to advancements in the arts and the sciences. Copernicus had proven that the Earth was not the center of the universe. Columbus was sailing around it, proving that it was round and not flat. Leonardo was making his discoveries, and Europe was entering a new age of enlightenment. Also, Venice is one of the two cities we're going to be visiting that I consider to be cities of love. Paris is the other one. And in both cities, love and romance really seems to be a priority. Then, in the 18th century, trade routes were opened up around the Cape of Good Hope, and Venice was bypassed by the trading ships of the world. Her heyday was over. But in a way, a more interesting time started, the time of gamblers and intrigue. Casanova came from Venice. Well, it's late in the afternoon, and the rays of the sun are bringing out those bright, vivid colors again. The lovers are on their bridge, watching the sunset. Venice prepares for nighttime. This is not a city that sleeps after dark. Venice is a city of carnivals and festivals. And if even on any one night there won't be a carnival, there are always thousands of carnival masks staring out at you from every storefront window. Their eyes seem to be beckoning, hoping to be bought and worn to the next big party. Very few people leave Venice without at least one carnival mask in their luggage. After a few days in Venice, we were on a train heading north through the Austrian Alps to the city of Innsbruck. While Linn and the band were playing that night, I found a room in a very old and a very charming part of the city. I woke up the next morning the sound of a river flowing by under my window, and children playing. Linn was up early, and she told me that you don't want to spend a nice day like this indoors in Austria. As we looked out the window at the Alps, she told me that she knew of a place where a cable car would take us to the top of one of them. The cable car starts in a little town called Eagles, and a beautiful ride it was. There's Innsbruck in the distance with the little town of Eagles on the foreground. Finally, we punched through a cloud, and we were on the summit. I've climbed Mount Whitney in Southern California a couple of times. At almost 14,500 feet, it's the highest mountain in the lower 48. It's beautiful from up there, but nothing like this. This looked as though we were on top of the world. There's the little town of Eagles, and on the way back down, cable car, we got a real good look at it. The Julie Andrews movie The Sound of Music was filmed near here, and Linn told me that ever since she had seen that film, she always wanted to come here and run through a field of tall grass with flowers. Well, she got her chance. They're a little town of Eagles on the outskirts of Innsbruck, Austria. The trip the next day was not very long from Innsbruck to Salzburg, but it was the most beautiful train ride of this whole trip. First, we got quite a glimpse into history as we passed one medieval castle after another, always on the high ground. That's because back before modern air power and artillery, he who had the high ground had the power. These were feudal times and the rules were simple. If you were the lord of a castle, you had power and wealth, you controlled the land you surveyed, and to keep what you had to maintain an army of well-trained knights. If you were a peasant, you were called a serf, and you worked for the lord of the castle. You tended his stock and his fields, and in return for this, he would protect you. When the knights of some rival lord or maybe bandits were in the territory, he would take you behind the walls of his castle and you were protected. This was back at a time when if you were a peasant and not under the protection of the lord of a castle, you really were out in the cold. Then, just over 250 years ago, a true genius was born here in Austria. He was born in Salzburg, our destination. You're listening to his music now. His name was Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. So I'm going to let his music and this train take us through his homeland. Salzburg, a beautiful city, divided in half by the Salzach River, and overlooked by the largest intact medieval castle in Europe, the Hohensalzburg Fortress. Salzburg was founded by a bishop, and it's always been a center for religion and the arts. There's a cable car that will take you 400 feet up to the castle on a stone plateau. The castle was here long before the city of Salzburg. What a beautiful countryside this is. The castle was originally made of wood, but then later the wood was replaced by stone blocks. This castle overlooked a very strategically important valley, where many of the armies of the day had to march through to get to their destinations. This meant that the lord of this castle had to make sure he controlled all he surveyed, cannon pointed out to all different parts of the valley. Life behind the walls of these castles were safer than on the outside, but by no means comfortable, unless you were the lord of the castle or somebody very close to him. Very few parts of these castles were heated, and it was bitterly cold here during the winter. And this was back at a time when people believed that bathing was unhealthy, so nobody did. In the winter, to keep the heat in and the stench in, they piled layer and layer of clothing, one on top of another, sometimes 15 or 16 layers by the end of winter. But eventually spring came along and everybody had to get undressed. Imagine what life was like behind these walls at that time. The window of the torture chamber angled downward, so the screams from here would be heard by the people below as a warning to everybody not to do anything to displease the lord of the castle. The executioner and torturers lived in that little house. Nobody wanted to live near them, and for good reason. Some of the rules were pretty tough. In certain parts of Europe, a bride was expected to spend her wedding night in the bed of the lord of the castle, giving her virginity to him rather than a new husband. Tough rules to live by, but if they were disobeyed, somebody would be heard screaming from behind the window of that torture chamber. Today, Salzburg is one of the most popular tourist destinations in Europe. And then on January 27th, 1756, a true genius was born in this yellow house, Mozart. If God ever gave a gift to anyone, he gave one to Mozart. He was writing and performing music at the age of 5. The first time he ever touched a piano and a violin, he immediately knew how to play them. He never had to learn music. It was born in him. He wrote perfectly the first time with no corrections, as though he was hearing the music already composed in his head and just taking dictation when he wrote it down. He was precocious and playful with a childlike spirit, except in music. Here he played with an adult genius. He could play anything perfectly the first time and in different styles. And his home has been perfectly preserved as it was when little Wolfgang played around here. His father Leopold saw nothing wrong with making money from his son's genius. Every year he would pack up the whole family and travel around Europe performing for the nobility, and always featuring little Wolfgang, and almost always being paid with gold rings, gold watches, and gold snuff boxes. Except one time in Prussia, when the Princess Anna Amelia paid by kissing little Wolfgang all over his face. His father Leopold was furious. He said, "My son performed brilliantly, now he feels as though he's been punished." What 7-year-old boy wants to be kissed all over his face by a strange old Prussian princess? And this was how and where Mozart grew up. His family was never poor, they were also never rich, they were sort of middle class, but they did have the noble connections because of the music. Then at 26 years of age, Mozart met and married Constanze Weber, the love of his life. They moved to a place not too far from where he had grown up. Mozart said that Constanze had no wit, but common sense, a giving nature. She was loving and affectionate, and they were happy. At one time, Mozart met and befriended a young and upcoming musician named Beethoven. It's not known whether they worked together, but it is known that they respected each other's work. Mozart's music will live forever, but his health was always frail, and finally at the age of 35 he died in the arms of his wife. Some say that he was a victim of an assassination by a rival named Salieri, but nobody will ever really know for sure. There's one thing that is for sure. American fast food is spread throughout the world. This might be our most endearing gift to the other countries. The Colonel, Burger King, McDonald's are everywhere. And today, 8 million people a year visit Salzburg, possibly to see the largest intact medieval castle in Europe. Or maybe just to get a glimpse into the life of a genius. The next morning, we were up early to catch a train north on our way to the city of Berlin, Germany. I noticed something very interesting. We were crossing international borders, going from one European country to another, and never did anybody come on board to check a visa or a passport. You can go from one country to another in Europe as easily as you can go from one state to another in the US. Then when we crossed the border from Austria into Germany, the scenery outside the window changed. Germany seemed to have a harsher, colder look, and a much more regimented look. rolling through some of these larger cities, they reminded me of the World War II movies I've seen all my life, with soldiers and spies climbing on and off trains in these stations. But once you get out into the countryside, Germany is just as beautiful as any other European country. We rolled into West Berlin that night just about the time the sun was going down, and while Linn and the band were playing, I went window shopping. I thought by what I had seen from the window of the train, maybe Berlin would have a harsh, cold look, but it didn't. On the contrary, it had a very upscale, fashionable look, like Rodeo Drive in California, or maybe Paris. The night sky was showing the symbols of German engineering, sharing the darkness with American fast food. In a way, Berlin is like a living museum, where some bombed-out buildings from the Second World War still stand. This wasn't my first trip to Berlin. I had been here in 1990 to film a little bit of history happening. The Berlin Wall was coming down. This ugly symbol of the Cold War had stood for 29 years, built in 1961, cutting the city in half overnight, almost, trapping family members and loved ones on opposite sides of the wall, sometimes for the rest of their lives. In certain areas, buildings were used as part of the wall. Their windows were barred up and the wall was connected to both sides. In some areas, the Berlin Wall is actually two walls running parallel with a killing zone here in between. Anybody crossing here was immediately shot, and 52 people lost their lives in those first few days. Today, people from the East and the West had left graffiti on the wall showing their sentiment about it. In the early days, a few people did escape, so the wall was improved. High-voltage wires were run along the top, preventing anybody from climbing over. The electric wires were even connected to the bars of the windows, electrocuting and killing anybody who merely touched them. The wall had some powerful enemies right from the beginning. Shortly after it was built, President Kennedy came here and in a speech said, "I am a Berliner," to show his solidarity with the West. And shortly before the fall of communism in Europe, President Reagan came here and said, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall." And now it was happening. Yeah, there really was no future for the wall, but the way it was coming down was interesting. Not with a powerful wrecking ball, but with millions of tiny chips. Anybody could rent a hammer and a chisel and go to work on the wall. And everybody did. The Berlin Wall was actually chopped down by tourists from all over the world and carted home in their luggage. Even me, I sent a whole bag of it home to my friends. Almost everybody I know now has a piece of the Berlin Wall. Just a year ago, these men might have been looking at each other over the sights of a gun. Now they were getting to know each other, and the face of Europe was changing. The wall was starting to look a lot like Swiss cheese, and to some people, certain parts of the wall seemed to be more attractive than other parts, so ingenuity had to be used to get to them. Kind of felt like one big party. East and West German guards were flirting with pretty Western tourist ladies, and the feeling of celebration was intoxicating. I realized I was shooting some very historically significant footage here. This will never happen again. Back during the Cold War, there was only one place where you could officially come and go from the Berlin Wall, Allied Checkpoint Charlie. At this time, you could still come and go from East Berlin in a semi-official way. You could drive or walk across the border. There was no customs, but immigration would give you a stamp in your passport. I actually crossed a couple of times that afternoon to get those souvenir stamps in my passport. I knew I wouldn't be able to get them a short time later. When you get into the East, guard towers are still there, but the machine guns are gone. And in the East, like in the West, there seemed to be this feeling of celebration everywhere. But there were nowhere near as many people in the East. The sidewalks were kind of empty. They said people were over in the West shopping. And just here on the east side of the wall, the buildings had a much harsher, run-down look. Also a much more regimented look. Much different than the affluent West, only a few hundred yards away on the other side of the wall. But the farther you get into the eastern part of the city, the old buildings still stand and they still have their classic charm. Now this has been a prison city for 29 years, but finally we're all welcome to come visit, so there was a massive renovation going on. These were the cars of East Berlin. They're cheap little things. They break down almost the day after you buy them. Everybody hated them, but everybody had one. And with an exception of their color, they were identical. The only kind of cars I saw that trip. They sound like little Japanese motorcycles when they're going by. The farther you get into the eastern part of the city, it becomes more and more beautiful. Berlin means built on a marsh, because it was, and a river runs through it. The symbols of the Cold War were still prominent. This was at a time when the working class were the heroes of society. You were supposed to really only work for the good of the state. Personal ambition or a desire to get rich could get you into a lot of trouble. Nobody was supposed to rise above the other people. This was a time when uniformed police and secret police were traveling around keeping dossiers on everybody, causing 29 years of paranoia. Of all the buildings that I saw in East Berlin, this big observation tower was the most interesting. As I walked toward it, I realized how tall it really was. There's a high-speed elevator that will take you up that stem to the observation globe on top. And from up here, you get a beautiful view of East Berlin. On this trip, I noticed something very interesting about the East Berliners, a prevailing feeling of paranoia. Now remember, this had been a prison city for 29 years. That means an entire generation of people had grown up, never knowing a time before the wall. Well, now they were officially free, but they didn't really know how to be. They had no experience at it, hence the paranoia. I was crossing East Berlin one morning on one of these trains, and I was able to film an example of this. I really wish that we had train service in the States like they have in Europe. This is really the way everybody travels here. And on one of these trains, I was crossing, and I filmed a gentleman who didn't know who I was. I wasn't saying anything, so he didn't know that I wasn't German. Maybe I'm in the secret police. Maybe I'm compiling a dossier on him. Well, whoever I am, he's not going to let me film his face. Subtle, but obvious at the same time. We're heading out of Berlin now, out of Germany, going west to Amsterdam, and the next destination for the musicians. This was springtime, and the Dutch countryside was beautiful. The yellow flowers are called rye, and they spread out on both sides of the train like a yellow blanket covering the landscape. Back 150 to 100 years ago in Paris, a new movement in the arts was taking place, the Impressionist movement. No longer did the painters have to paint the nobility or the royalty or the wealthy, they could choose their own subjects, and many painted the hard-working people of the land. The Dutch painter Vincent van Gogh was a pioneer of the Impressionist and the Post-Impressionist movement, and his first painting of any notoriety was The Potato Eaters, where he painted the hard-working people that he knew, sharing a meager meal of nothing but potatoes, but sharing it in an atmosphere of friendliness and camaraderie. The most charming little towns I've ever seen are located about 20 miles north of Amsterdam, Zaandam and Zandvoort. Everything here looks like a postcard. The cobblestone streets and storybook houses take you back to a time when the world walked to the tick of a slower clock. And of course, there are all the windmills. Over 100 years ago, Claude Monet came here and painted this. It hasn't really changed much since his time. Sundam is a tourist attraction, but it's not a tourist trap. There's no high prices here, no pressure. Just a charming old-world feeling. Many people come here to get married. Holland is known for a few things, like tulips, windmills, and wooden shoes. Lynn and I were able to find a store that had both in our size. The Impressionist painters travel around a lot, and it's not really hard to see why. With scenery like this all around them, how could they possibly stay at home or indoors? The two-tone cows here, banded Galloways. There's also plenty of cheese and all those windmills. The Dutch have been at war for years, but not with any people or any other country. They've been at war with the sea. Back during medieval times, the rising rivers and tides would flood the farmland. But then they learned to build windmills to pump the water out and dikes to hold it back. And they're still being used for the same purpose today. Late every afternoon, they pack everything up for the night. The next morning, they'll be starting it all up again. Unchanging pattern that's gone on for centuries. Quaint and old world now, but a few hundred years ago, this was cutting-edge technology. They not only pumped water around with the power of the wind, they ground grain and used it for many other purposes. You're going to see a few cute critters in this movie, and most of them are going to be sheep. What a wool sweater, huh? You know, I think that sheep are always itching, because sheep are always scratching. And she's cute. But he's cuter. And what you hear about sheep really is true. They really will eat almost anything that they can find. Time to head on south to Amsterdam. It was a short ride south through the Dutch countryside to Amsterdam, and the colors were beautiful. Cruising through the Dutch countryside, I noticed something very interesting about the trains in Holland. They all have something in common. They all have faces. They all look like yellow Snoopy dogs. And they're everywhere. You got Snoopy dogs going east, Snoopy dogs going west, even kissing. Yeah, the Dutch trains do have their charm. And Amsterdam has more canals than Venice. A good thing to do when you first arrive in Amsterdam is to take one of the boat tours. They're very comfortable, very informative. Amsterdam was named after the dam that was built over the mouth of the Amstel River in the 13th century. Both Venice and Amsterdam have canals, but they're very different cities from one another. Venice is a bright, colorful city in the warm Mediterranean sun, whereas Amsterdam is more of a shaded city, with glassy waters under a canopy of green trees. These tour boats are very informative. The guides will tell you everything there is to know about Amsterdam. As in Venice, there are a few big canals and many smaller ones leading off in all directions here. This floating Chinese restaurant was towed here all the way from Hong Kong. It's a good thing there were no big storms at sea during the crossing. They would have ended up on the bottom of the ocean, eating the fish. The people of both Venice and Amsterdam live surrounded by water. But unlike in Venice, many people in Amsterdam live on the water. There are a lot of houseboats here. Cruising past this little floating community, I have to admit I got a little bit envious. Imagine what it would be like to live in a place like this. I did wonder how they managed certain things like plumbing, but I guess they figured it all out. They seem to be able to provide everything that they need for themselves just floating here on the water. Even a floating playground for the kids. I think in Amsterdam, more than any other place I've ever seen, the people seem to have found a way to live in perfect harmony with the mirror calm water that surrounds their lives. Dutch laws are very liberal compared to the rest of the world. At any time, anywhere, you might get a whiff of marijuana or hashish on the wind, because both are legal and regulated here. Amsterdam is primarily a 17th century city where many of the old buildings lean out over the sidewalk. I found a room in a colorful part of town, but also a rather infamous area. This is the notorious red light district of Amsterdam. But it's not a bad part of town because, like pot, prostitution is also legal and regulated here. The girls are sitting behind storefront windows, as you would see in any department store in the world. But a word of warning, they say that a large number of the girls have the HIV virus, so window shopping is all that's really safe. The next morning, we were headed south toward Paris. Riding through the Dutch countryside, naturally there were a lot of windmills, but also something else. This is April, and April is tulip season in Holland, and they were flashing by the window in a barrage of color that I've never seen. It's early in the morning, morning mass in Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. Of all the cathedrals I saw, this one was my favorite. The Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte was coronated within these walls. Outside the cathedral on the walls, there are a few interesting statues and reliefs. One of them is of Saint Denis, who was executed by the Romans in the 4th century. They beheaded him. But he didn't want to give them the satisfaction of dying in their presence, so after they chopped off his head, he picked it up and walked away to die in privacy. He probably walked over here to the left bank, the older part of Paris, where many of the famous outdoor cafes are found. Paris has some very liberal laws. If you don't hurt anybody, steal anything, or do any property damage, you can do just about anything else you want, it seems. Drinking in the streets is legal in Paris. As we know, the French do like their wine. This guy might lack it a little more than most. I asked somebody if they knew his name. They say, we just call him the greeter. A 100 years ago in these same outdoor cafes, a new movement was beginning in the arts, the Impressionist movement. The Impressionist movement had an interesting beginning. Vincent van Gogh was one of the pioneers, and when he first arrived in Paris, he met Paul Gauguin. Now, Gauguin might be the most interesting guy in this story. At the age of 25, he was on his way to becoming a very wealthy young man in Paris. He was a stockbroker and a banker. He married a Dutch lady named Meta Gad and began what would become a very big family. But Gauguin wasn't destined to make his living in the world of finance. He was destined to be a painter, much to the dismay of his wife, Meta, who had to watch her husband go from a lucrative career to the life of a starving artist, while she was beginning what would become a very large family. Gauguin had another family now, though, also the other painters of Paris. They were together every day. They loved the Dutch countryside. Many of them chose to paint the hardworking people of the land just outside of Paris. Although some of Gauguin's paintings had a spiritual or a religious theme, in reality, he was quite a cad and a womanizer in his private life. He was raised by a very exotic mother in the South American country of Peru. He grew up to a handsome man, with a seemingly insatiable appetite for the ladies and enough charm to almost always have his way. At least according to some of his diaries. And the art that these men were creating was a fascinating one. Impressionism. What that means is that everybody gets a different impression when they look at a scene. Everybody sees something differently. For example, a photograph of a beach looks like this. But one impressionist might see it like this, with the sun coming in through the early morning clouds. Another impressionist might see a stormy sea with wind and waves threatening people on the shoreline. They all took the opportunity to add their own impression. To Claude Monet, a bridge like this looked like this. They also loved the way that water and sunlight played together. At one time, Monet went to London, took a room overlooking the river, and did a whole series of fog paintings. He was fascinated by the way the fog filters in the sunlight. And he really created a feeling, an impression. You can't do this with a camera. Two painters named Signet and Seurat created a style called pointillism or neo-impressionism. By putting thousands of colored dots on the canvas, they could create a picture. And they really wanted to make you think. They wanted to stimulate the imagination. For example, is this a painting of three boys on a beach, or is it a painting of one boy on a beach at three different moments in three different positions? Makes you think. And modern art was being born. On the left bank here, all of the roads angle downward toward the river, and they all have a gutter running down the middle or along the side. That's because back before toilets and plumbing, flushing meant throwing it out the window. Certain hours of the day were known as flushing hours, at which time the maids up on the fourth floor would holler out, "Gare de l'eau," which meant look out for the water. And it wasn't all water, and she'd heave it into the street below where it would finally make its way to the river. Very few people were out strolling during Gare de l'eau hours. Most of the Impressionists loved the bright sunny days, but the night belonged to Henri Toulouse-Lautrec. He painted the seedier side of Paris, the nightlife, the saloons and the brothels. His favorite hunting grounds were the famous Moulin Rouge nightclub. At any one night, you might see a bunch of painters down here, Gauguin, Van Gogh, Lautrec. They'd be partying while he'd be painting or sketching. Here's a picture of him in the distance with his friend, the tall man. Toulouse-Lautrec was very small, less than 5 feet. But his stars, the people of his paintings, were the beautiful people of the day, the stars of the stage, and also the ladies of the evening. He felt a real kinship with prostitutes. He felt like him, they were looked down upon by society. He also loved the circus. Look at the sneer of the rider when the ringmaster sneering back at her. He could create true human feeling with only a very few lines. After a night of carousing and partying, the painters might be stumbling back along the river. Past scenery, it hasn't changed a bit since their time. With an exception of the clothing that the ladies are wearing here, everything else looks exactly as it did 100 years ago. Even the Eiffel Tower, built by the architect Gustav Eiffel for the 1889 World's Fair. Like that observation tower in East Berlin, the closer you get to the Eiffel Tower, the taller you realize it really is. About 900 feet to the top. There are high-speed elevators that will take you up to the top. And once you get up there, you get a beautiful view of Paris. Built for the 1889 World's Fair, this was here at the time when Gauguin and Van Gogh were painting. They got to see this site long before airplanes were invented. They must have marveled at the modern city in which they lived. When it was built, the Eiffel Tower was the tallest man-made structure in the world, topping the Great Pyramid in Egypt. I was finding charming little hotels all over, but the one I found here was my favorite, the Hotel Esmeralda, more than 300 years old. That's not wallpaper on the walls, it's green cloth. And since the hotel was over 300 years old, my room was about the size of a large closet. But like everywhere else that I was finding, had a beautiful view out the window. This one might have been the best of all. Notre Dame Cathedral, right across the Seine River. On Sunday morning, in front of Notre Dame, there's quite a show going on. I come from Santa Monica, California. We've got some pretty good skaters out there, but we have nothing on the skaters of Paris. Interesting, the most appropriate music I could find to go along with this scene was written more than 250 years ago by Mozart. Notice how they seem to be dancing to the music here. I was moving around getting different camera angles to try to capture this action. They never quite ran into me, but they came pretty close a couple times as they came flying over, or almost flying over the boxes. That's about as close as it got. If this had been a competition, this guy would have been the winner of the day. The month was April. April in Paris. And one of the nicknames for Paris is the City of Love, and the name really fits, especially at this time of year. The lovers are everywhere. In the parks, in the cafes, walking along the street corners, flying along the banks of the river. I spent one morning doing nothing but filming lovers, and by the end of the day, I had found the best two lovers in Paris, at the zoo. In my travels, I've learned that there's nothing in the world that can neck like a camel. I was trying to imagine what they might be saying if I could understand camel. She might say, "Kiss me here," and he said, "You mean here?" And she said, "Yeah, that's the place." The necking's not all there is to it, because after the necking is over, the ankle biting and the chase begins. Every animal has its own courtship ritual. I'd always wondered how camels do it. I think she might have been enjoying all the attention until this other would-be suitor joined in, and she was not ready for a ménage à trois that day, so that was it. Another name for Paris is the City of Light. This name also fits. On the warm days, you find hundreds of people sunbathing along the banks of the river. The whole city seems to glow. I think that if all of Europe had one capital city, it would have to be Paris. In Venice, the gondolas are romantic. In Amsterdam, the tour boats are very comfortable and informative. But I've never seen tour boats like the ones that I saw in Paris. That's a tour boat. These enormous vessels sail up and down the river all day long and into the evening, serving lunches and dinners in the restaurant below. As they have for centuries, artists and art students still come from all over the world to paint Paris. They're drawn here by the same forces that brought Gauguin and Van Gogh here more than a century ago. But Vincent Van Gogh got tired of the cold winters of Paris, and he had a dream. He believed that he could start an art colony in the south of France, in the town of Arles. He believed that, like himself, other Impressionist painters would be drawn to the warmer air and the brighter colors in the south. So he boarded a train and took off for the south of France. Now, Vincent was coming down here to get away from the cold weather, so imagine how he felt when he stepped off the train in this station into 6 inches of snow. But it was all right, it was winter, and he knew that the weather would warm up. He was a happy man. He had left the life of a city painter for the life of a country painter. Arles was already an ancient city when Vincent arrived here. It had been built close to 2,000 years earlier during the time of the Roman Empire, a dangerous time when most of the cities were walled. Much of the old wall and the old Roman gate still stands. The people of Arles had helped Julius Caesar defeat Marcellus. This earned the town an imperial nod, and it became an important port town on the road between Spain and Italy. This was Roland the postman, Vincent van Gogh's first friend here. Van Gogh was always good at finding people to help him when he needed it, and like most postmen, Roland knew the city pretty well. He was able to help Vincent find his first lodging here, right on this narrow little road. number 30. It hasn't changed. Now Vincent settled in and began to paint. At the end of this narrow little road is the old Roman arena. 2,000 years ago, gladiators killed wild animals here. Cruel. Today, matadors still kill bulls here. Still cruel. But Arles is a jewel of a town in the south of France. Really a living museum. Cars actually look pretty out of place here as they squeeze down these narrow little roads and around these old Roman corners. Well, the place that Roland had found for Vincent was fine temporarily, but it would never suffice as an art colony. So when the weather warmed up, Vincent went off in search of a new place to live, and he found one just outside the old Roman gate. Very near the place that I found a room. Right on that patch of green grass where the dogs are playing, used to stand a building. Like many, it was bombed out during the Second World War, but before the bombing, what used to stand here was known as the Little Yellow House. Ideal for Vincent's art colony. Downstairs was a small saloon, and upstairs were tiny bedrooms. Ideal for the painters that Vincent hoped would be coming. His dream didn't have a chance, though, without the help of his brother, Theo Van Gogh, an art dealer in Paris. He contacted Gauguin and told him that if he would help his brother start the art colony, then Theo would support both of them. The three men agreed, and the two painters met in the little saloon. No two more different people ever tried to live together than these two. Here's how Gauguin saw the saloon, with smoke in the air, a dark quality, and the owner welcoming her guests. Vincent saw it as a bright room with glaring yellow lights. They started to paint the people and places of Arles. This is Dr. Gachet, an art connoisseur and patron of the arts, a medical doctor who treated most of the painters without charging them. He knew they didn't have the money, he probably saved a few of them. This cafe hasn't changed a bit since Vincent painted it in Cafe Terrace at night. Vincent Van Gogh was a voracious painter. At night he would put burning candles on his straw hat so he could paint canvases like Starry Night. Both men loved painting in the country surrounding Arles. Gauguin romanced many of the women while he was here, whereas Vincent really mainly just wanted to paint. He would paint a bridge like this in the morning, finish the painting maybe around noon, and then walk around the bridge looking at it from different angles. He might paint that same bridge again on the same day. This drove Gauguin a little crazy. He used to say, "Vincent, you paint too fast," and Vincent would snap back and say, "Paul, you look too slow." This is a garden in a hospital where Vincent often went for treatment, another one of his favorite subjects. Vincent liked to paint the same scene in many different ways. He might paint the garden on one afternoon, then come back a different day when the sun was a little bit different, and he would paint it again. This park on the other side of town from the Little Yellow House was another one of Vincent's favorite subjects. It's been dedicated to him and is still being used for the same purpose by artists today. And watching this guy paint with his comfortable baggy clothes and his straw hat, I realized that he might look a little bit like Gauguin or Van Gogh would have looked here 100 years ago, possibly painting in exactly the same place. But the art colony would never come to pass, and the friendship between the two artists was doomed. The problem was over a woman. Now, Gauguin romanced almost everybody he found, but Vincent didn't, except he did love one, a prostitute named Rachel. Gauguin probably didn't even know how he felt when they got together, whether he was just being Paul Gauguin. But when Vincent heard about it, he was crushed. He felt betrayed by his best friend and the woman that he loved. It was Christmas Eve, and he went down into the saloon, where he said that the bright, glaring yellow lights could drive a man mad. Well, I think he might have gone a little bit mad that night, for he walked out into the darkened streets of Arles, a changed man now, with hatred in his heart and a straight razor in his hand. He was looking for his friend to kill him. He walked through the old Roman gates, and what comes next comes right out of Gauguin's own diary. He said, "I was walking through the night. It was still, dark, and cold. But then I heard a familiar sound behind me. Footsteps. Staggered. Irregular. I turned in time to see Vincent rushing at me with a horrible look in his eye and a razor in his hand. When he saw the fear in my eyes, he stopped. I looked at the razor. I said, "Vincent, are you going to kill me?" He screamed yes and took another step forward. But then again, he saw the fear in my eyes. He lowered the razor and screamed no, and he went running off towards home. Vincent did go home, and with that razor, he cut off part of one of his own ears and took it to Rachel. Then he went back home and fell asleep in a pool of blood. Gauguin, who had stayed somewhere else that evening, came home in the morning, and the police, who had discovered Vincent, arrested him. They said, "What have you done to your friend?" Well, he was able to convince them that he was innocent. They allowed him to board a train back to Paris. The two painters never saw each other again. But this incident really sort of put Vincent over the edge. Now he began to slip into insanity. Dr. Gachet was called, and he was able to help Vincent get admitted to a mental institution in Saint-Rémy, just north of Arles. And in the institution, under the care of Gachet and the other doctors, Vincent did begin to improve at first. But it was only temporary, because then he began to slip slower and slower into madness, as the self-portraits show. His brother Theo was called, but it was too late. Even the presence of his loving brother couldn't save him now. He was too far gone. His only therapy seemed to be painting. He did more than 70 paintings in 2 months. But then, out in the fields one afternoon, after finishing a canvas that he called Crows Over a Wheat Field, he removed a revolver and shot himself in the stomach. He agonized for 2 days and finally died in the arms of his brother. He was 36. Neither of the painters ever saw Arles again, but Gauguin's life took an interesting turn. He went to the South Sea island of Tahiti, where he spent a year painting. When he returned, his family was growing. His oldest children were now teenagers, and he truly loved them. Here's one of the rare pictures of Gauguin sitting between his daughter Aline and his son Clovis. But by now, his wife Meta had had it with this starving artist. When he failed to sell his paintings from Tahiti, she left him and took her children back to the Netherlands. Then Gauguin's luck turned even worse. His biggest problem always seemed to be the women he chose to be with. For then he moved in with one of his models, Anna, the Javanese. Anna had a monkey. And one day, Gauguin, the monkey, Anna, and a few of their friends were walking along the Brittany coast of France, and they were accosted by a large group of Dutch sailors. Actually, Anna was receiving racial insults, and Gauguin sprung to her rescue. Now, Gauguin was a pretty big man, about 6 feet tall, and a very proficient boxer and fencer. But he was badly outnumbered on that day, and there was a fight, and he received a very badly broken leg, broken so badly it never healed for the rest of his life and caused him a lot of pain. And then Anna went back to his studio in Paris and destroyed most of his canvases and disappeared with most of his money. With this, Gauguin decided that he had had it with Europe. He had lost his family and everything that mattered to him. He went back to the islands of Tahiti, where he was happy for a while. But then he received news that his favorite daughter, Aline, had died of pneumonia. This Gauguin decided to take his own life. He tried, but he failed and survived, and then married a Tahitian. He knew by now that due to his injuries and failing health that he was never going to live long enough to become famous during his own time. But he knew that someday his paintings would be. Now he said what he really wanted was to give the artists who followed him the right to dare everything. And the artists who have followed him, people like Pablo Picasso, Marc Chagall, have credited Gauguin with being a primary forefather of modern art. We've left Arles, and we're on our way to the castle of Le Beau. Le Beau is a castle fortress that once dominated this whole region. It was built on a limestone hill that was already a natural fortress. The early builders just added to what was already here. This was at a time when merely surviving was a daily challenge. Le Beau overlooked the beautiful Provence countryside. This was a proud city of princely adventurers and lords. Through powerful alliances, they successfully defended their independence for 5 centuries. From the murderous raids of rival families that wanted to control Provence. The rival families were one thing, and King Louis XIII was another. When the lords went up against him, he laid siege here for 27 days, and finally Le Beau fell under the control of France. Not too far from Le Beau, another walled city, Avignon. The Vatican in Rome has always been the center of Catholicism, but for a while the Catholic Church had 2 popes. In the year 1309, Pope Clement V got fed up with the decadent and unholy lifestyle in Italy and moved north to the south of France and built the Palace of the Popes, where he lived for 94 years. Then in 1378, a new pope was elected in the Vatican, so for about a quarter of a century, the Catholic Church had 2 popes. Now Avignon is sort of a center for tourists who want to visit the beautiful Provence countryside. and see the French Riviera. On the train heading down to the Riviera, we were passing old farmhouses, and I thought a lot about the people who used to live here under the control of the Lords of Le Beau and the Pope in Avignon. People from all over the world are drawn to the French Riviera. They're drawn by places with names like Cannes, Nice, and Monaco. Cannes is our first stop. Cannes is truly the playground of the rich and famous. From the older part of the city, there are a few high vantage points that will give you a beautiful 360-degree view of everything. You can look this direction towards Spain, or this direction towards Italy. Cannes is best known for the International Film Festival, which takes place here every year in April or May. Movers and shakers from the movie business all over the world come here to compete, and so do many people hoping to get a glimpse of their favorite stars. But if you want to be here during that time, you have to make reservations about a year ahead of time, and it's expensive. But if you're a filmmaker, coming to Cannes might be worth it. Any filmmaker who wins here, that's money in the bank and guaranteed success. Cannes has a sandy beach, unlike most of the beaches on the Riviera, which are rocky. On the other side of the main road from the beach is a park, and on every Sunday they have what they call an antique art show. I did see antiques and art here, but I also saw the same kind of junk that you see in American swap meets every weekend. You go in that direction for 20 miles and you arrive in Nice, really the capital of the French Riviera. With a rocky beach, Nice is much larger and much less expensive than Cannes. And to go back in history, you just go to Old Town. Pub Van Gogh. Actually, Gauguin, Van Gogh, and the others came here frequently. It wasn't hard. Train travel 100 years ago in Europe was very good, and most of the European countries are smaller than most of the American states, so getting around was really not a problem. You go 17 miles inland from here and you arrive at St. Paul de Vence. Of all the mountaintop towns and castles in this movie, this one is by far the most beautiful. It overlooks the spectacular Provence countryside. Many people consider Provence to be the most beautiful part of France. But as beautiful as the countryside is, it might be as beautiful or even more beautiful inside. St. Paul de Vence literally sparkles with color and activity. Some famous artists who chose to live here in the 20s brought world attention to Provence, but fortunately, the tourists didn't come and ruin the place. It still managed to keep its old world charm. As Lynn was traveling around and I was making this movie about these artists, she was becoming more and more interested in old painters, and here she found the one who turned out to be her favorite. His name was Marc Chagall. He painted at the same time that Pablo Picasso was developing his style called Cubism here. It's said that Chagall was a little bit jealous and envious of Picasso because Picasso was more well-known. But in my opinion, Marc Chagall had nothing to be envious about. He was a master of color and uplifting images. He painted humans cavorting with mythological creatures in almost every imaginable way. In my opinion, he took modern art to a new level. He and his wife had a passionate love. He painted many pictures of both of them flying together out over town and country. His Yellow Christ was very much like Gauguin's. He also liked to use reoccurring images like violins. You find them in a lot of his work. If Chagall could truly separate himself from the way most people saw the world and show to us what only he saw in his vivid imagination through his work. It was not an easy life. He was a Russian-born Jew who fled the Nazi Holocaust in 1941. Many of his paintings show a world at war, but others are rather humorous, like this self-portrait where he gave himself seven fingers. After his first wife died, he traveled the world, all through Mexico, the United States, all over Europe. Then he finally met and married Vanna, the second love of his life. Now, Chagall was very wealthy by now. They could have lived anywhere that they wanted to, but they chose to live here in St. Paul de Vence. And it wasn't hard for me to imagine why. It was easy to imagine Vanna and Mark eating in the outdoor cafes before it was time for him to go home and paint for the day. What better place for an artist in love with color to live? Just down the road from St. Paul is a very unique gallery. Art gallery, but not too many paintings here. Most of them are statues of water and movement. And it was here that I found the most fun work of art I've ever seen. Really almost more than a work of art. When you enter here, you're kind of entering a new world. It was sort of a hypnotic world. People were walking around in sort of a trance, or just standing in one place with a glazed look over their faces. Outside is just a big metal grid with thousands of pieces of yellow plastic hanging spaghetti. But as soon as you enter here, you enter a world of children. Even me, I know that the moment I went in here, I went back to about 7 years of age. And it's impossible to be in here without smiling. Nobody can get the grin off of their faces. It's impossible. With my camera, I can show you what this looks like. There's no way in the world I can show you what this feels like. We're back on the train, heading down along the French Riviera, and flying above us was a paraglider. This sport is becoming very popular in Europe. We're going to see a little more of it later. But for right now, we're on our way to a very unique community, kind of like an old kingdom, even though it's called a principality, the Principality of Monaco. Monaco truly is the playground of the rich and famous. Here I saw the biggest privately owned yacht I've ever seen with a helicopter on the top deck. Monaco is best known for the Monte Carlo Casino, but I wasn't allowed to film in there, and they only really make about 3% of their money from gambling here. But in Monaco I got a chance to try something I never thought I'd get a chance to try in Europe, our first submarine ride. You climb down, they close the hatch, and take you out to a place where a boat sank in about 100 feet of water a few years ago. When we got to the right spot, the captain announced that we were going to dive, and soon we were down 100 feet, cruising along this old shipwreck. And while doing this, I was thinking a lot about the community on the surface. An amazing community. As long as the Grimaldi family can continue to produce male heirs, they'll hang on to Monaco, and France will not be able to tax them. Prince Rainier married Grace Kelly, an American movie star, a few years back to carry on the family tradition. And in Monaco during the Second World War, Nazi officers and Jewish businessmen actually stayed in the same hotels at the same time. Nowhere else in the world did anything like that ever happen. After about an hour on the bottom, it was time to surface, and we did so pretty quickly. Soon, sunlight came flooding into the front of the craft, and we were back on top. It was late in the afternoon by now, and the sun was sparkling off this rich little bay like diamonds. You go for just over 300 miles in that direction. You enter a new country, Spain, in the city of Barcelona. Barcelona literally sparkles with color and activity. The center of the action here is a boulevard called the Ramblas. Back during medieval times, it was a drainage ditch. It's improved considerably since then. Now you find bird markets, flower markets, quaint cafes, elegant restaurants, pickpockets, prostitutes, and some of the most interesting street entertainers you've ever seen. This guy doesn't work too hard. About once an hour, he does this. And that's it for the hour. But if he thinks that's easy, try to stand in that position for just 10 minutes without moving. You only have to walk one block off the Rumblus and you've gone back to medieval times and the Gothic Quarter. The street that Lynn's walking on was once walked on by Christopher Columbus. He first met with King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella in one of these old buildings after his first return from the New World. This cathedral took 150 years to finish. But this one was finally completed, and this one wasn't, but this is the most fascinating building I've ever seen. The Cathedral Sagrada Familia, or Sacred Family. Built by an architect named Antonio Gaudí. Gaudí turned the city of Barcelona into an amazing showcase of his very unique architecture. This cathedral is the biggest, but the city is literally full of his work. His art was his life, and his faith was his toil. He was devoutly religious, and he worked normal religious symbols into very abnormal and unusual backgrounds. Like Marc Chagall, he truly saw life through the eyes of an artist. And only through his work could he show us what he saw. He was never able to finish the cathedral. He died before its completion. The inside is the unfinished part. Here you have 300- and 500-foot spires reaching toward the sky. And from these towers, you get a beautiful view of Barcelona. When I was a boy, I was a Boy Scout. I always remembered we were going somewhere fun and interesting, so I'm glad we followed this troop, because they led us to Gaudí's Mountain. On a hill just north of the city, Gaudí built what he hoped would be an upscale housing project. As that, it never succeeded, but here he managed to work together with nature and create a truly marvelous place. I have no trouble including Gaudí with artists like Gauguin, Van Gogh, and Mozart. In my opinion, he belongs in that kind of company. I've never seen anything man-made look so much as though it was made by nature, but not really the nature of Earth, more like the nature of some other planet. Walking around inside of Gaudí's work, you get the feeling that you've entered the imagination of an artistic genius, which I guess you have. Gaudí worked indoors as well as out, and back in the 1920s, he created lines that were decades ahead of his time. Gaudí finally died at the age of 101 under the wheels of a streetcar. At the time, he was still healthy. Who knows how long he would have lived? He might have been able to finish his cathedral. Antonio Gaudí. And the next day, we were headed north to the last gig on the tour, in Geneva, Switzerland. The city of Geneva sits on the end of a banana-shaped lake, Lake Geneva. On the north part, the Swiss Alps, and south of the lake, the French Alps. And the Swiss Alps are rolling hills where medieval castles overlook the farmland that they have for centuries. But today, instead of farmland, often they overlook modern cities. But they still hold the high ground as they always have. I was the filmmaker, but in this area, Linn turned out to be as much of a photographer as me. The whole place did look like a postcard. We rented a car and took a trip around Lake Geneva, going through one little alpine village after another. At one place, we even saw the Swiss Army on maneuvers. And even though I never really saw one, I know that they had to all be carrying Swiss Army knives. I'd be surprised if anybody could recognize this town. But I bet almost everybody can recognize the name. This is where the water comes from. This is Evian. And this is the town of Montreux on Lake Geneva, where they have the Montreux Jazz Festival every year. Lynn told me that every musician wants to see that at least one time, but we weren't here during the right time of year. And it was getting late in the afternoon, time to take off to Geneva, where Lynn and the musicians were going to play. While they were playing that night, I went window shopping, and window shopping in Geneva is a glittering experience. As you know, the Swiss make some of the finest timepieces in the world, and they all tick and shine at you from every storefront window. The night sky is filled with names that we've come to associate with quality in the world. You can even get a Swiss Army knife watch here. And you get to see master watch and clockmakers working at the trade that they have for generations in their own family. The next morning, there was a cloud in the Alps. A moving cloud. The Alps is really the most mystical mountain range I've ever seen, especially early in the morning when the clouds are dancing in the trees. Well, the musician's tour was finished, but I wanted to see a place in the French Alps that I had always heard of, a town called Chamonix, and the road to Chamonix was spectacular. The colors were so bright, they almost hurt your eyes. Imagine what it would be like to live here, or here. Yesterday, on the other side of Lake Geneva, in the Swiss Alps, it was mainly green rolling hills, but here in the French Alps, it was high snow-capped alpine peaks. And nestled in among them, quaint little alpine villages. Chamonix is best known for two things, skiing and mountain climbing. But this was not winter, so there were no skiers, and we didn't see any mountain climbers. But just by chance, when we drove into Chamonix, I looked up, and I saw something I wouldn't have seen if I hadn't. People in parachutes were jumping from the high snow-capped peaks and gliding down to Chamonix below. I was lucky enough to find the place that they were all going to land in time to film them coming in. Yeah, parachutes have come a long way since Leonardo da Vinci designed this one about 500 years ago. Unlike the umbrella-shaped parachutes that we're used to seeing, these parachutes are shaped more like wings, and the jumpers are more like pilots. And no longer do they have to come crashing into the ground and roll, now they just sort of land at a walk. Make it look easy, don't they? Looks like man finally has learned to fly like a bird. Almost. When I first saw this guy, I thought he was in trouble, but he's not. He's just very good at what he's doing and showing off for his friends. I think each jumper was more skilled than the one before, and this guy might have been the best. For example, imagine that he had a bag on his left side. If he did, he could drop his whole parachute right in his bag. Well, we've spent a month traveling through seven countries in Western Europe, following a modern-day artist working and looking back into the lives of seven amazing artists of the past. Names that anybody can recognize, but you might know a little bit more about them now than you did before seeing this film. I know a lot more about them than I did before making it. So from Lynn, myself, and all the people of Western Europe, I'd like to thank you for traveling with me again, and I'll see you again next time.